Let me begin by saying a few words about myself and how it was that I came to think of myself as a skeptic. I am from Barcelona, Spain, and Catalan. Non-nationalist, no? A city that I'm sure you have heard about lately. A lot of news, some of them fakes, but anyway, I'm not going to bore you with this, just a few words in the end. Decades ago, Spain was a Catholic country, and my father, who wasn't a religious person but was very conservative, sent me to a convent school. He hoped that this would be the best way to accept traditional values and become a good girl. As a result, from the age of 7 to 10, I remember carrying an scapular everywhere I went. A scapular is a typically Catholic devotional ornament made of two rectangular pieces of cloth, paper, or wood. It is worn so that one piece of the scapular hangs down in front of the wearer like a pendant. The other rectangle hangs over the person's back, with bands running across the shoulders. My scapula was made from two brown cloth squares tied together with a string. According to Pope John 22, the purpose of this object is to allow a person who dies to obtain an early release from purgatory through the special intercession of Virgin Mary. I remember I even wore my scapular when going to the beach, just in case I drowned. But in the end, vanity. Vanity worn out as the two bits of fabric, generally filthy, ended up in the back of the drawer. When the scapular was abandoned, I was also the beginning of my rejection of superstitions. As far as I recall, I never again really succumbed to any religious or secular superstitions, to any old wise tales or magical beliefs. No broken mirrors, no black cats for me. Indeed, as I grew to maturity, I became more and more skeptical and gradually decided that I was an atheist. My chosen reading were books on science, and I developed a fascination for Carl Sagan. It goes without saying that it was a disappointment for the whole family when I refused to baptize my son. My son was still very young when, at the age of 20, a child of the 60s myself, I set off to live the life of a hippie in Formentera in the Balearic Islands. By then, it was the height of the 70s, and there were all sorts of crazy ideas about Oriental philosophies, alternative medicines, and energy pyramids. I'm sure you will have an idea of the kind of thing that I'm speaking about. Because I had already developed a critical questioning attitude, I'm afraid that I became something of an annoying or even insufferable hippie. I simply asked too many questions. I began to realize that I didn't not really fit in with sort of lifestyle. So I abandoned Formentera and decided to return to Barcelona, where I studied anthropology at university. From this point, my life began to take a quite different course. 20 years ago now, I began to move in the circles of an Spanish organization known as ARP, the Alternativa Racional a las Pseudociencias, or the Rational Alternative to Pseudoscience. I quite quickly became its director and continued in that post for a couple of years, leading a team that exposed charlatans of all sorts, including the charlatans that abound in the media, and in the process, such things as miracle cures or visits from UFOs. Later, inspired by the ideas of John Brockman, I set up an association called Tercera Cultura, or the Third Culture. The association was matured into a concerted analysis of a whole range of social subjects from a scientific perspective. I was armed with the belief that I had developed over the course of my life that I, once again, found a critical attitude of views. This time it was in a political context, given that one way or another, the path that I have adopted led to me to my being elected to the European Parliament as a part of the Alliance of Liberal and Democrats for Europe. From this privileged position, I am optimistic that I will be able to make the voice of skepticism and secularism heard in the heart of Europe. And to this end, shortly after arriving in Brussels, I founded a platform, Euromind, that organize events in the Parliament with a view to strengthening the ties between the scientific and the political spheres. I have invited, for example, Richard Dawkins, Michael Shermer, or Susan and Steven Pinker. At this point, let me turn to the use of critical thinking in the political environment and specifically in the context of European policymaking. The European Parliament strives to promote evidence-based policymaking and to avoid policy formulation based in absurd correlations and unreliable information, mythical notions, lies, or propaganda. In particular, there are three advisory bodies that are able to guide members of the European Parliament. Firstly, the European Commission benefits from the Scientific Assessment Mechanism, SAM, a small group of scientists who advise politicians on the wording of laws. However, it is only an advisory body and its decisions are not binding. Secondly, there is the European Food Safety Authority, or the EFSA, EFSA. This is the rough equivalent of the EU's Food and Drug Administration and is a highly prestigious international organization. In my opinion, the EFSA criteria are generally reliable and trustworthy, but not all MEPs feel the same. EFSA is an advisory body, and given that these reports are not binding, MEPs are able to ignore their conclusions and recommendations. Some argue unjustly that the EFSA merely follows the dictates of major multinationals. There is the Science and Technology Options Assessment, STOA, panel, an organization that studies the impact of new technologies on society and advises MEPs. I sit on this panel, and only a few days ago, I organized an event together with STOA on artificial intelligence with the participation of Steven Pinker. Once again, however, despite the very useful nature of the work that it does, this is only an advisory body. So, I don't know if you know this man, so there is plenty of high-quality scientific advice available to MEPs. However, because this information is supplied on a purely advisory basis, politicians are able to ignore the recommendation that they are given. Instead, or more often than you might think, they make decisions guided by ideas that simply shock rational, informed skeptics. Let me give you some examples. Oops. The EU has produced a mountain of rules for a whole set of products ranging from clothes, dryers, cosmetics, cucumbers, fruit jam, laptop computers to laundry detergents, from vacuum cleaners to light bulbs, olive oil, plastic bags, refrigerators, shower heads, television sets, toilets, urinals, and wine cooling cabinets. Most famously, the EU has introduced a whole series of laws concerning bananas and cucumbers. For instance, cucumbers should not have more than 10 millimeters curvature for 10 millimeters of length. Examples of this sort could be multiplied indefinitely, and they all amount to a mountain of paper and red tape. They are, for instance, 14 pages of densely packed legal print devoted to the regulation of ecological lights. A little more critical thinking in the domain works surely led to the conclusion that passing laws without any really valid reason is both unnecessary and undesirable. The second point that I would like to make is that in the absence of proper scientific analysis, there is a systematic tendency to rely on absurd correlations. An example that caught my attention was a law linking climate change with gender politics. It would appear that global warming is a result of patriarchal attitudes. Other point are absurd claims from politicians. An example that I remember derives from the political differences between Madrid, the Spanish capital, and Barcelona. This involves the tension between national and regional politics. Not long ago, a Catalan MEP lodged a complaint with the Commission. This was because Pepe, a Real Madrid player, has fooled Messi, a Barcelona player, during a football match. Pepe had then allegedly stamped on Messi's hand. The Catalan MEP considered that an act in the head of a football game should be considered as a political affront and that he was motivated by a political desire to defend the authority of Madrid. Certainly, European politics might benefit from concentrating on matters of real interest to its citizens, improving employment opportunities, economic growth, and social well-being, for instance. However, rather than devote themselves to such tasks, it would seem that some politicians are easily distracted. Instead, they find themselves engaged in producing what I have come to see as either merely homeopathic laws or laws that are based in an idealized version of the natural world. What do I mean by homeopathic laws? Homeopathic laws certainly appear to be well-intentioned, but they are often as ineffectual as placebo. Homeopathic laws do not set any mechanism in motion to reach the goals they seek to achieve. One example is a law passed in June of this year aiming to prevent thousands of tons of food in perfectly edible condition from being simply thrown away. As the law itself acknowledged, the food chain in Europe is highly efficient and the industry has very little margin to reduce waste even further. Hence, the problem does not lie on the production side of the food chain, but on the side of consumption. After considering the matter in great detail, it was eventually concluded that the law should stipulate that member states should promote awareness-raising campaigns. That is all very well, but I have no doubt that the law will simply have no effect whatsoever. If homeopathic approaches are generally as harmless as they are ineffectual, there are also cases in which homeopathy has more serious consequences. Rejecting medical advice in favor of advice delivered by quacks is not necessarily the best possible path to follow. A cancer patient might choose, for example, to resort to natural remedies rather than chemotherapy, and in so doing, to choose a much less effective treatment. A similar situation is found in politics when instead of confronting a difficult choice head-on, politicians opt for a natural but ineffective solution. Energy policy is an example. Europe has an agenda that aims to ensure that the energy used by European citizens is clean and to prevent the use of greenhouse gases. As things stand, nuclear power is the only way to achieve this goal. For the moment, alternatives supplied by solar and wind power provide less than 1% of the total energy used in the world. As a result, Europe produces an ambitious target, but is unable to actually adopt the means to achieving these targets. Since there are no plans to build new nuclear plants, EU emission reduction goals will be not met and the price of energy will increase. As you can see in the image, there is a correlation between the price of electricity and installed solar and wind power. The more wind and solar power, the more expensive the electricity. Political leadership, I feel, is not only a matter of being able to determine appropriate goals, but also of ensuring that the means are in place to achieve these goals. This brings to me a second characteristic of much EU legislation. This is a tendency to assume an idealized version of nature as opposed to artificial human products. An example of a preference for an idealized nature is the fear of man-made chemical products. However, sometimes the use of such products is restricted or banned without there being any valid reason. This is the case of glyphosate. Glyphosate eliminates weeds efficiently, safely, and effectively. The European Food and Safety Agency has ruled that it is innocuous, so there shouldn't be any problem with its use, should there? It is not so simple. Glyphosate is produced by a multinational called Monsanto, and for some, at least, Monsanto represents evil incarnate. Ecologists in particular claim that it can be altered hormonal imbalance. However, when it asks what the alternatives are, it turns out that our farmers should be using the juice of lemons. This week, the European Parliament has decided that in 2022, glyphosate will be banned. This has been a defeat of science. Another example that I should like to mention, undoubtedly the most alarming, is that of transgenic products. Following the case of studies, analysis and meta-analysis, solid data have been produced to support the fact that consumption of these products is not in any way harmful to health. In 2016, an open letter signed by more than 100 Nobel laureates not only stressed that genetically modified crops were no more harmful than crops that have been modified by thousands of years of selective farming and natural cross fertilization. Let me quote for the letter. Scientific and regulatory agencies around the world have repeatedly and consistently found crops and foods improved through biotechnology to be as safe as, if not safer, than those derived from any other method of production. There has never been a single confirmed case of a negative health outcome for humans or animals from their consumption. The letter finishes with a plea. How many poor people in the world must die before we consider this is a crime against humanity? Hesitant when it comes to HMOs, the European Union actively supports organic agriculture, which are less efficient and hence more expensive. The result is that European agriculture is held back by excessive precaution and the economy suffers. Now, secularism. It would seem that politicians and the media are perfectly capable of making uninformed as opposed to informed decisions. The solution I have suggested lies in adopting a critical attitude. This critical attitude depends on scientific protocols of hypotheses, the generation of reliable facts and testing, and not on mythical analogies and unlikely correlations. These are principles, and they are available to humans in this world, and hence do not rely on metaphysical notions of divine intervention in the world. Indeed, critical thinking of the sort that I have been discussing goes hand in hand with secularism. Such secularism is also a valid response to the challenge of how to integrate large numbers of immigrants from different religious and cultural horizons. Secularism is more than just the principle of separation between church and state. Secularism is more than just a legal principle. It is an ethical and civic perspective that is essential to human morality. European societies are based on values such as freedom of expression, freedom of association, and freedom of worship, and respect for such principles are a sign of integration into European society. An authentically secular state guarantees freedom of worship for all citizens, and it also guarantees the right of non-believers to reject religion. If multiculturalism turns out to mean that disrespect for such values is under threat, then clearly multiculturalism has been a failure. Those that hold secular belief, wherever they might be in the world, remain our natural allies. It was in this spirit of friendship that I had the pleasure of inviting Mariam Namazi to the first talk I organized in the European Parliament. Namazi, a former Muslim, is an activist of Iranian origin who currently lives in London. She denounces the pressure exerted by Islam on those wishing to abandon their beliefs. There are many harrowing accounts of the pressure that former Muslims are subjected to when they renounce their faith. There are, for instance, accounts of the criminalizations of atheists in Muslim societies and of atheists who are subjected to death threats. Apostasy remains punishable by death in certain Muslim countries, including Iran and Saudi Arabia. What thought of Islamophobia? Christopher Hitchens said, "Islamophobia is a word created by fascists and used by cowards to manipulate morons." It is Islamophobic to denounce the punishment of apostasy? What about the compulsory wearing of a veil and the way in which such attitudes marginalize women and maintain them under the yoke of their husbands? It is Islamophobic to resist the imposition of Sharia law and to insist that one legal code dependent on principles of democratic representation and applicable to all those present on the same national territory? At present, I fear that even Voltaire, who wrote Mahomet, a play that represents the prophet as a fanatic, would be accused of Islamophobia and his play could well be censured. For some, particularly on the left, it would seem that the criticism of fundamentalist Islam is associated with ethnic or even racial prejudice. However, this would also be to condemn the Voltaire of the Treaty on Fanaticism and to suggest, paradoxically, that the criticism of intolerance is itself intolerant. Something similar could be said about the fatwa imposed on Salman Rushdie after the publication of the Satanic Verses. Freedom of expression includes, it goes without saying, Salman Rushdie's novel. Even so, there were politicians that accused Rushdie of having provoked his attackers and hence of having brought this fate down on his own head. As lapsed Muslims often explain, to excuse the excesses of Islam is to play into the hands of the fanatics and to abandon our secular allies to their fate at the hands of religious fundamentalists. If Salman Rushdie is a prominent victim of Islamicism, the French Rushdie is a professor of philosophy by the name of Robert Redeker. After criticizing Islam in a well-known French newspaper for the forced wearing of the veil, amongst other criticisms, Redeker was forced into hiding and has been living for the last 10 years, I think 12 years, with police protection. I have remained vocal in defense of my friend. Beyond my activity with Euromind, my parliamentary work is also based in a defense of my values and principles. I have also actively voiced concern, along with ALDE, my group in the parliament, with regard to the situation of non-believers in post-coup Turkey. I have also lent my support to recent democratic reforms aimed at achieving equality between men and women in allowing interfaith marriage in Tunisia. Similarly, last June, my group has called on the Pakistani government to repeal the blasphemy laws laid down in the penal code and to annul all death sentences based on charge on blasphemy, including the sentence against Taimur Raza. We have also drawn attention to the case of Mashal Khan, a Pakistani student who was lynched by a mob of fellow students after having been accused of publishing blasphemous material online. Similarly, we have directly expressed our concerns at the attempt made by the Pakistani authority to force Twitter and Facebook to disclose information about their users. This information was to be used to identify individuals suspected of blasphemy. So, fellow secular humanists, let me finish with a call to arms, albeit in a metaphorical sense. We must stand firm in our opposition to any movement that seeks to criminalize critical opinions and free speech in the name of religion. There can be no respect for universal human rights, no true moderation, when the rights of non-believers and so-called apostates are not truly respected. The 750 million people worldwide that do not profess religious belief are our friends and natural allies. I believe that we should listen to their concerns and take an active role in defending their fundamental right to live a good life, whether it be holy or not, in peace with others. I also like to add something about the current sad events in my home country, Spain and its richer region, Catalonia. Don't be fooled. It's not about democracy. What we are witnessing is the madness of crowds at work, the power of collective narcissism. Fortunately, at least half of the population is free from that lethal political virus, nationalism. There is still hope for Catalonia, Spain, and Europe. Thank you very much for listening.